sponsor this whole symposium, which is a 3.5-day event. And these evaluation forms that were in your chair when you came in are something that's required by the Humanities Council. It also helps us in planning future programs, but if you would take just a few minutes to make the briefest comments about this program after it's over, we would appreciate it. It helps us fulfill our requirements to the Humanities Council. And then without delaying any longer, we'll get started in this, which is the fifth program in the Harlem Renaissance Symposium being held in conjunction with the Harlem Renaissance Exhibition, which is on the second floor in the lower Stallworth Gallery and on the first floor in the hallway as you go from the foyer to the elevator. And don't forget that part. A lot of people don't realize that's part of the show, and those are the banners and photographs. Today's topic is the jazz tradition, the history of African American music, and we can hardly have a more qualified speaker. His name is Mr. John Armwood. He lives in Atlanta, where he's lived for the past 5 years. Previously, he was in New York City. He's managed jazz groups on the international scene. He's produced concerts, jazz concerts. He's produced dance when he lived in New York City. And as his second profession, he came to... He did come to Atlanta to get his law degree, and he is now there practicing in entertainment law. He has a collection of over 4,000 jazz recordings, and he can tell you more than I can about him himself and about jazz. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Beth.
I think we have some power now. Yes, I've had a love for jazz basically all of my life. It was something that I was called to. I didn't really choose it. It chose me. I started buying records like most teenagers do. And after coming through a period of listening to a lot of rock and rhythm and blues, I started hearing jazz recordings that attracted me. And it became almost an obsession. I started to buy records constantly. I would work while in college, a lot of part-time jobs just to buy records on the weekend. And started to grow more and more into the music. Eventually started writing for a jazz publication out of New York, and through that started managing artists and producing concerts, and eventually lecturing, and trying to spread the message of this great American music form around the country and the people from around the world. Let me give you an idea of how we're going to organize the program today. What I'm going to do is I'm going to talk a little bit about jazz at the beginning, place it in a social context. I look at the music sociologically. Then we'll start listening to some recordings. I'll introduce recordings, play tapes of various jazz artists. We'll do that for about an hour, hour and 10 minutes. Then after that, we'll watch a series of film clips of some great jazz artists who I'll tell you about later. And then we'll have time for a question and answer period. So the whole program should last a little under 2 hours. What is jazz? Jazz is a name that's been generally used to describe the instrumental music of African Americans in North America. It's the name that's been given to describe the music of people like Louis Armstrong, of course, Jelly Roll Morton, Duke Ellington, Charlie Parker, John Coltrane, Lester Bowie, David Murray, various artists that played an instrumental, largely improvised music. A lot of musicians in the tradition of jazz have objected to the use of that name simply because they've looked at the name as being constricted, and the music is such a broad type, a broad style, that there's so many different people playing the music that it's really hard to categorize it. And by doing it, you separate it from its cultural roots and other musics in the world. In fact, Duke Ellington used to make the comment all the time that the category of jazz was too narrow a category to encompass the many and diverse talents who were put together under that label. And he, after 1943, stopped using it. Jazz can be best understood as the music of Africans in the New World. It reflects the cultural experience in music of Africans who were brought from West Africa as slaves to primarily the southern regions of the country, and their migration through the early years of the 20th century to large cities in the Northeast and Midwest. In our listening today, we're going to start and look at some of the musical techniques that were developed in West Africa, which were carried on to the New World and became the technical foundation of jazz. Like any other cultural experience, as the cultural breadth of the people who are experiencing it broadens. They assimilate the various experiences that they go through. So when Africans came to the New World, they encountered musical instruments that were made in Europe. They took these instruments, though, and adopted them to the musical approaches and musical expression which they had used in Africa. And we'll see in a little while how closely related those expressions are, the music of Africa, West Africa in particular, and the music of North America that Africans brought. And of course, with any musical expression, it, once it is exposed to people, people from all walks of life, from all cultures, will assimilate it, will absorb it, and join it in performing it. So now jazz is performed all over the world. You won't find a major city on the planet Earth where you won't find jazz. From New York to Hong Kong, from Tokyo to Sydney, Australia, to Soweto, South Africa, to Lagos, Nigeria, you'll find jazz. You'll find jazz throughout Brazil and South America. So the music has traveled all over the world, but its essence and its root starts in West Africa and comes to America. First the South, and then throughout the cities of the Northeast and Midwest. Many jazz historians and jazz critics date the start of jazz around the turn of the century with the era in American culture that we call ragtime. I don't accept this dating of jazz. I look at the roots of the music, and I see the music as starting a little bit earlier than that. I date the beginnings of jazz to the end of the Civil War and the period of time when African slaves were freed and musicians were able to move from one plantation to the other and share musical experiences. Also during this period at the end of the Civil War, the musicians who had been freed were able to go out and purchase varying instruments. And they began to develop a style of music to entertain themselves, which we later called ragtime and we now call jazz. Many of us see the style of ragtime as being a music that was primarily played on the piano. Due to the popularity of people like Scott Joplin and their music, we associate this music with just the piano as an instrument. But historically, if we look back into the records of the 1870s, 1880s, and 1890s, we'll find that this musical style was played by small and large bands. And these bands entertained people, primarily men, in the various sporting houses and clubs that developed along the Mississippi River as part of the opening up of the Louisiana Territory after the end of the Civil War. And where you had a lot of industry around the shipping towns, you tended to have a lot of men without families. And they would gravitate toward the bordellos and the sporting houses. And this early form of jazz was a form of entertainment that was used in those entertainment spots. We're going to start off listening to some music from West Africa. We're going to hear a player from a region of Senegal where the Mandinka people are from. And the Mandinka were very prized slaves in the Western Hemisphere. They were known for their ability to work hard and long. They were a very strong people of a very strong stock. They had been fierce warriors in West Africa, but who were conquered after the decline of the Songhai Empire in West Africa in the early part of the 15th century, AD, the early 1400s. And after the decline of the Songhai Empire and its breakup, West Africa went into a period of dark ages. And during that period, she was susceptible to the slave traders, first from North Africa, the Berbers, and then later on from Portugal and Spain. But we're going to hear a kora player, who is a Mandinka, playing on the kora. From that, we're going to move over to the Mississippi Delta and listen to a blues player playing a guitar on a prison farm in Angola, Louisiana, around 1959. And I want you to listen to the similarities between the instrumental technique used by the kora player in West Africa and the guitarist, the blues guitarist in Louisiana. You'll notice that they both strike the strings in a very percussive way. You'll notice that they both have a narrative vocal style in their singing. But you won't hear very much of singing with the kora. When the kora players do sing, they sing of the exploits of a great leader of their community. They sing of the history of a particular family. They sing of the legends of a culture. The bluesmen in North America lived in a much narrower world. Because of the economic system of slavery and later discrimination, He was limited to singing about the experiences that he experienced. He didn't have close contact with kings and lords, but he did have close contact with an economic system that oppressed him, and he sung about that. He sung about the difficulties of harvesting crops on poor land. He sung about the difficulty of holding together families and local relationships in an economic time that was very, very hard and did not provide work for people in a way that would allow them to have families. So the sadness of the blues is directly related to the socioeconomic environment that it evolved in. And the blues is not necessarily born of that misery, because if you go into any West African village, you can hear blues being played. And later on, when we look at the video, I'll show you a West African bluesman playing on a West African guitar called gimli. That'll be later on. Right now, we're going to listen to a West African kora player of the Mandinko people, and then a Louisiana bluesman.
Thank you.
insect that attacked the cotton crop, and then his difficulties with his girlfriend, wife, the woman in his life. And as we all know, those things are very closely related to economics and family stability. So we can all relate to that in the blues. Next, we're going to look at a comparison between an early brass band, a 1923 recording of King Oliver. King Oliver was a New Orleans band leader, trumpet player. He was the person who provided the model for Louis Armstrong. If you look at the lineage of the jazz trumpet, you start with, in New Orleans, a legendary figure by the name of Buddy Bolden, who never recorded, but who by legend could be heard playing the trumpet from one end of the city to the other when he would lead a brass band marching in the streets. And it was in fact that young Louis Armstrong was on this recording. And then we're going to go over to Ghana and listen to a West African brass band playing more recently in the 60s, but it's in a village where the musicians had never heard any jazz, but they were playing on Western brass instruments. And you can see the similarity in style, which develops out of a common vocabulary and a common instrumental approach. First, a 1923 recording of King Oliver doing a composition composed by pianist composer Clarence Williams. And then we'll hear a Ghanaian brass band. A composition once again by Clarence Williams' High Society. Instrumentalist of playing instrumental music tends to mimic the sound of the human voice, and those who sing tend to mimic the sounds of instruments. So you have that cross-fertilization of the voice and technology in the music, and you can hear that in the way the trumpets and trombones were played by both the King Oliver Band and the Ghanaian Band. Now, another early influence on the music we call jazz was the piano tradition that was particularly important along the Mississippi River towns. And a lot of the smaller sporting houses and bordellos and clubs, they couldn't afford to hire a band. They would hire a piano player. And the piano players would entertain the guests in the clubs. And out of that tradition, the piano music we call ragtime developed. And these musicians being probably the most trained of the African-American musicians, trained in the formal Western sense, because of the use of the piano being a very Western instrument, and there's a need for knowledge of basic harmony to play the instrument, these musicians tend to incorporate more and more elements of the European music, and the music that the Europeans have brought to America. And you find the first and earliest of the cross blendings between the music of African Americans and the music of Europeans in early ragtime. And in fact, composers like Scott Joplin composed the opera, which combined the elements of the early ragtime jazz style and 19th century European classical music. And Tremonition, Scott Joplin's opera, is a very good example of that. We're going to hear a recording of a Scott Joplin composition entitled Euphonic Sounds by a pianist by the name of James P. Johnson. So most of you probably don't recognize the name, but I can guarantee you've heard his music. The piece, The Charleston, that I'm sure most of you have encountered at some point in your life, was composed by James P. Johnson. He was a stride pianist, a pianist who worked in Harlem during the 20s and 30s. And there, the pianist worked for various rent parties and dance parties. If you wanted to make your house rent for the month, you'd throw a party, put on some greens and some pig feet, and charge a nickel at the door, and you'd get your rent paid, and everybody would have a ball. Various piano players from the community would come and play. They would put a can on top of the piano and collect tips. People like Duke Ellington, Fats Waller, Willie the Lion Smith, Jack the Bear, James P. Johnson, among others, Count Basie, William Basie, got their teeth cut in these type of parties. And the piano players would cut each other. And James P. Johnson was considered to be the dean of these pianists. And here we have a 1930s recording of him looking back at the ragtime style and playing Euphonic Sounds, a Scott Joplin composition. From there, we're going to go on to a piece composed by James P. Johnson, the one that I mentioned before, The Charleston. And this piece will be played by one of the great Harlem pianists, Willie the Lion Smith. And Willie the Lion Smith would wear a black derby hat, have a big cigar in his mouth, and glasses. And he would challenge all the young pianists and tell them, you had to get past me. If you want to hang in New York on the scene, you have to sit down and try to outplay me. And you're not going to do it. So he would intimidate all the young pianists. So we'll hear first James P. Johnson doing Euphonic Sounds, and then Willie the Lion Smith doing a James P. Johnson composition, The Charleston.
Thank you.
We can see the evolution of the piano style, first that Mississippi River style, the ragtime style with its elegance and its formalism, to the much quicker, much more dance-oriented style, which became known as stride or Harlem piano. The name stride comes from the fact that if you're listening to that piece of Charleston, you heard the left hand of the piano player keeping a constant, almost walking tempo. That was to give the dancers a rhythm to dance by. And the comparison is always made by musicians to that of a deacon walking very stately in church, carrying a bass line. That later on in the music as it became orchestral music, was that role was played first of all by the drummer and later on by the bass player as the music evolved. And we'll talk about that more later on and on. Just to mention, when we look at jazz, the evolution of jazz, there are two major areas where the music evolves and changes. On the one hand, the music becomes more complex as time goes on rhythmically, and the music becomes more complex, on the other hand, harmonically. And just between the two pieces we heard, the ragtime piece, which was composed around 1906, and the Charleston, which was composed in the late 20s, we see a definite evolution in the music rhythmically. And the music of the Charleston became much more complex rhythmically, with very interesting rhythmic patterns being played on the right hand, and the accompaniment thing, that steady walking beat on the left hand. So we have Mississippi River style and of piano playing, and we have the New York Harlem style. To add to that group, now we're gonna put in the New Orleans piano style. And the first of the great jazz composers came out of New Orleans. His name was Ferdinand Morton, nicknamed Jelly Roll. And we're gonna hear a piece of his which became very, very influential in the development of the swing era. This piece is called the King Porter Stomp. And King Porter was a great early New Orleans jazz band leader. And we'll hear first a solo piano rendition by Jelly Roll Morton, Ferdinand Jelly Roll Morton. And then we'll hear an orchestral version of the same piece done by the great jazz band leader. In fact, the person who formed the first swing band, his name, of course, is Fletcher Henderson. And we'll hear his version of King Porter Stomp. And that was recorded back in 1932. The Ferdinand Jelly Roll Morton solo piano version was recorded in 1939. Though Jelly Roll Morton composed that piece during the 19-teens, it was not recorded until later. There's actually a 1920s recording, but this is a better sound quality recording, so I decided to use that. And on the orchestral version, with Fletcher Henderson, you'll get to hear the first of the great tenor saxophone players, Coleman Hawkins, take a solo. Now, Fletcher Henderson formed his band around the time 1919. And by 1923, young Louis Armstrong had left King Oliver's band and had joined Fletcher Henderson. So King Oliver and Fletcher Henderson were two of the great early band leaders. King Oliver playing in the traditional New Orleans style, and Fletcher Henderson being the architect of the swing era. Later on, during the late 30s, he was to write the first big band arrangements for Benny Goodman and his band. In fact, the King of Swing built his orchestra on the arrangements of Fletcher Henderson. And we're going to hear some Fletcher Henderson much earlier, 1932. First, Jelly Roll Morton, then Fletcher Henderson. Thank you. That's correct. He was playing tenor saxophone.
Oh, I thought
the clarinet. player was Edmund Hall.
He does the
solo, tenor saxophone solo right after the clarinet solo and before the trumpet solo. Okay, in fact, Coleman Hawkins was the father of the tenor saxophone as a serious instrument. It had been invented by a German instrument maker by the name of Adolf Sax in 1898, but it was only used as a novelty instrument in circuses and parades to make funny sounds. But Coleman Hawkins took it and developed a coherent, intelligent solo style, which became the first influence on an instrument, irrespective of musical style. He was the first person to do anything really with it. And his first work was with the Fletcher Henderson Band during the early 20s. First recorded, of course, in 1923, when African-American artists were first recorded. That was the first year that African-American artists were recorded. It was 1923. Okay, right now we're going to hear the opening cadenza to one of Louis Armstrong's most famous solos. It's the opening cadenza, of course, to West End Blues, recorded in 1927. And then from there, we're going to go over to 1928 and listen to a duet between Louis Armstrong and Earl Father Hines on piano, entitled Weatherbird. Now I want you to notice the bravado trumpet style. And remember back to the King Oliver Band, which I played earlier on this afternoon. And remember that you didn't really hear any solo was standing out. Well, out of that band, Louis Armstrong started to take short little break solos with King Oliver on trumpet. And as time went on, he began to expand them and expand them. He left King Oliver and went to Fletcher Henderson and started to solo more and more. And by 1927, he had developed a brand new solo style. Now, he wasn't the only one to do this. There was also a saxophone player and clarinet player by the name of Sidney Bechet, who was also to develop a very early solo style. And in fact, some would argue that his style matured earlier than Louis Armstrong. Duke Ellington felt that way. And my listening to recordings tend to justify that also. But we'll be hearing Louis Armstrong first, and then some Sidney Bechet. Once again, the opening cadenza to West End Blues, and then a duet with their old father Hines entitled Weatherbird. Now, in the duet, listen to how this piano music that we heard earlier evolves. You'll hear Earl Father Hines with the right hand playing sounds that sound very much like what Louis Armstrong was playing on trumpet. And in fact, from this time onward, jazz musicians would imitate on other instruments the sounds of horn players, particularly piano players. Later on, during the 40s, bebop pianist Bud Powell would imitate on the piano the sounds that Charlie Parker played on the alto saxophone. Louis Armstrong, we'll hear first the opening cadenza to West End Blues, recorded in 1927, and then the duet Weatherbird with Earl Father Hines, recorded in 1928.
Thank you.
see the level of virtuosity that these early jazz players had. And Louis Armstrong brought a level of technical proficiency and emotional expressiveness that had never been experienced in music before. His personal statements on the instruments were unique to his own playing. His conception was fresh and individual, and it communicated to paupers and to kings and queens on a very, very emotional, very visceral level. Right far behind, we could hear he and Louis Armstrong exchanging ideas and playing back and forth. This pattern of answer and response, or what's called call and response, harkens back to the music of West Africa, where you'd have a vocal singer singing and a chorus answering in response, or to the African-American church tradition, where a preacher will preach and the congregation will respond. This became a core element in this music that we call jazz. You hear it in the orchestration of the music of Fletcher Henderson, and probably no better expressed than in the music of America's greatest composer, Edward Kennedy Ellington, Duke Ellington, where he brought this form of call and response to the level of the highest art. We're gonna hear three pieces by Edward Kennedy Ellington. First, a wonderful 1927 composition entitled Black and Tan Fantasy. And it features a great trumpet player who was an early influence on Duke Ellington by the name of Bubba Miley. Now, Bubba Miley developed a technique of playing trumpet using a bathroom plunger. And what he would do is he would use the plunger and make growl sounds. What had happened was in 1926, Irving Mills, Duke Ellington's manager, got the young band leader from Washington a job working in a club in Harlem called the Cotton Club. And I'm sure most of you have heard of the Cotton Club. The Cotton Club was a hangout in Harlem for basically gangsters and wealthy downtowners from New York who wanted to come uptown to Harlem and get a little of the exotic quality of being around Africans. And so the club was set up with an African motif. The band was called the Jungle Band. And Duke Ellington created these beautiful musical images of Africa for the club owners. And the thing that was so special about what Duke Ellington did was that he brought a level of dignity to it. In a sense, what the club owners had expected was some form of parody of the African experience. But Duke Ellington brought to it a majesty and a dignity. The dancers that performed in front of the band, the Cotton Club Revue, developed a new American, indigenous African-American dance form. And when we watch a film called Symphony in Black in the video presentation today, you'll see some of that dancing going on, particularly the dance of a gentleman by the name of Earl Snake Hips Tucker. And with his nickname, you have an idea what he does. Well, this was part of the exotic flavor of the Cotton Club. And unfortunately, African Americans could only come in the club to perform through the back door. But the music that was developed there became a major influence on American music. And what was so important about the Cotton Club was that it was hooked up around the country by telephone. And it was the broadcast of the music in the club was sent all the way across the country. So people and band leaders across the country got to hear Duke Ellington's music. So it was imitated and copied throughout the country. And for the next 40, 50, 60 years, up until now, it created the largest book, the largest collection of large orchestra music that has been produced in this country. And Duke Ellington is the only composer in Western culture going back to the 16th century who was able to have an orchestra at his disposal whenever he wanted it. Duke could write a tune at 2 o'clock in the morning, call his manager at 2:30, and call a band rehearsal for 10 o'clock. His men, for his whole career, were on the payroll. He would take the royalties in later years from his popular hits to subsidize his band and keep them working when other bands disbanded. In fact, his band was the only jazz orchestra not to disband during the 50s. I mean, bands like Benny Goodman, who made more money than any other band leader, were forced to disband. But Duke Ellington subsidized his band, was a very shrewd businessman, lived a very frugal lifestyle, and kept his band going so he could compose his more significant and serious works. We're going to first hear a 1927 version of Black and Tan Fantasy, then a 1933 version of a piece entitled Daybreak Express. I played Daybreak Express for a couple of reasons. The first being, it's the first recording that encompasses the sounds of a train. It's the first composition in Western culture which incorporates the sound of a train into it. And it gives a summer indication of the influence of technology on 20th century music. And you hear the orchestra imitating a train. In modern music, in the music of the 70s and 80s, we see through the use of electronic instruments, orchestral sounds which imitate technology, which imitate machines. Here we have an early illustration of acoustic instruments imitating machines. Dugdelington also experimented with the use of the human voice as an instrument. And we'll hear a 1947 recording entitled Women of the Lavender Mist. Woman of the Lavender Mist, a beautiful imagery of Duke Ellington. And we'll see Duke Ellington combining the orchestral voices of his band and the sounds of a human voice. He first used this in a piece called Creole Love Call in 1928 with singer Adelie Hall. But here we'll hear the 1947 Lady of the Lavender Mist. So three pieces, Black and Tan Fantasy 1927, Daybreak Express 1933, and Lady of the Lavender Mist, 1947. And you'll hear the evolution of Duke Ellington's instrumental technique. I knew I was going to do that. I forgot a piece. See? Before the Duke Ellington, I forgot to play the Sidney Bechet. Well, that happens. Excuse me one second, I have to rewind the tape slightly. I knew I was going to do that. First of all, we're going to hear a 1941 Sidney Bechet piece. I mentioned that Sidney Bechet was one of the early great jazz soloists. So before the Ellington, we're going to hear Sidney Bechet doing a piece he calls Egyptian Fantasy. And contrary to what a lot of people believed in the 60s, jazz writers and African-American composers were very much focused on Africa. And I counted at one point 22 early Duke Ellington compositions, which either had a direct African reference or a reference to Harlem and the African American experience. And here we have a Sidney Bechet composition, Egyptian Fantasy, also relating to Africa. So first we'll hear the Sidney Bechet, and then the Duke Ellington. Thank you.
saxophone there. He also plays clarinet. And Sidney Bechet always gets overlooked, and it's so unfortunate. I even did it. The reason that he gets overlooked generally was the fact that during the early 30s, he left New Orleans and moved to Paris, and stayed in Paris until he died in 1959, and became a founding influence on the European jazz scene during the 30s. And that scene produced a lot of great musicians, one of them by the name of Django Reinhardt, who was really an original influence on guitar, gypsy guitarist, fantastic musician. Right now, though, we're going to listen to the three Duke Ellington pieces I promised you. Black and Tan Fantasy, featuring the jungle sounds of Bubba Miley, and also Joe Tricky Sam Nanton on trombone, who imitated the jungle sounds on trombone that Bubba Miley developed on trumpet. And then we'll go over to Daybreak Express, and we'll hear the wonderful reed section of Duke Ellington, and see his wonderful writing, and the intricate lines that he wrote for his reed section, something which was to presage what the bebop musicians would do in the 40s, during the next decade. And we'll end up with a very beautiful and ethereal Lady of the Lavender Mist, Edward Kennedy Ellington. Thank you. one voice. During the solo passage, it was the voice coupled with a bass clarinet. Okay, so you can see the beauty and the expressiveness of Duke Ellington's art. And Ellington continued to grow through the 40s, 50s, 60s, and even 70s. And from the 40s on, started composing long suites. And there are a dozen or so of them, and they're beautiful. Among them, the ones that you should pick up and listen to, and are beyond the scope of what we're doing here, are the Far East Suite, the Afro-Eurasian Eclipse, Latin American Suite, A Tone Parallel to Harlem, and on and on and on and on. Black, brown, and beige, a number of beautiful works. Next, we're gonna move over and listen to one of the great early jazz singers. Of course, the earliest, and many might argue the finest of the jazz singers was none other than Louis Armstrong. But his greatest pupil, and probably if he was the greatest, the next greatest jazz singer was, of course, Billie Holiday. And her influence as a Fraser was to change the direction of the American song from thenceforth onward. And we're gonna hear a wonderful 1937 recording of her singing I Must Have That Man, and she was singing that with a wonderful pianist by the name of Teddy Wilson, who was later to work with the very famous Benny Goodman Quartet. Teddy Wilson, the pianist. We have Benny Goodman playing clarinet, Buck Clayton on trumpet, and the great Lester Young playing tenor saxophone. Lester Young was the next great tenor saxophone player after Coleman Hawkins. He approached the instrument very differently. But Coleman Hawkins played the bottom of the horn, had a very masculine, what I like to characterize as a very macho saxophone style. Lester Young played a very beautiful, very light, very cool sounding style. And Billie Holiday nicknamed Lester Young Lady Lester. And that feminine quality in his sound is very, very evident, and you'll hear that. And when you hear the term cool jazz, the term cool in terms of music was first applied to the playing of Lester Young. And Billie Holiday and Lester Young were at one time romantically involved, but through much of their life, they were musically involved. And his singing influenced his playing influenced her singing. And we'll hear the two of them singing and playing together. And at some points, it's hard to tell when they play together, when one leaves off and the other starts. I Must Have That Man, 1937, Billie Holiday.
Caring just where I will end. I must have that man.
why do you play so few women jazz musicians? And why don't you hear about a lot more women jazz musicians? And it's a very legitimate question. Again, we have to look at the sociology of the development of the music. Unfortunately, the music developed in its early years in nightclubs, bordellos, cabarets. These were not the environments that were most suitable to single women out on the road playing music. So women tended in general to shy away from performing the music, though there were all women jazz bands starting from the 30s. And there's a wonderful book called Why Women Don't Have the Blues, which talks about a lot of them. And it's an Ida Cox song. But there were many. During the 40s in particular, people in the 30s, people like Mary Lou Williams out of Kansas City had a tremendous influence on the music and taught the two greatest of the bebop pianists, Bud Powell and Thelonious Monk, as well as fed them, took care of them. Melba Liston during the 50s was another great female artist, and then many, many more. But I just wanted to raise that point that the environment tended to be very, very hostile. And so you had tended to have less and less women on the road, and on the road is where you cut your chops and develop your playing. Next, we're gonna move to the music of Coleman Hawkins. Now, we heard Coleman Hawkins solo earlier with Fletcher Henderson on that great arrangement of Stomp. Fletcher Henderson had been on the road by 1939, over 20 years, touring and recording. One day he went into the studio, recorded a couple of records, and then there was one acetate left. And the engineer said, why don't you just play something so I can use up this tape? So Coleman Hawkins decided to ad-lib with his band a couple of choruses on the chord changes, on the melody of the classic Johnny Green composition, Body and Soul. He didn't even bother to play the melody, but he just played a solo based on the chords of the piece. This became a very, very big hit for him, and it marked his breakthrough. And this beautiful version of Body and Soul is now considered to be probably the finest of all jazz solos. And we're gonna get to hear this spontaneous, beautiful rendition of Body and Soul by the legendary Coleman Hawkins, the father of the tenor saxophone. This was recorded back in 1939. This was totally spontaneous, unplanned, one take, and you see what you get. The beauty, the wonder of jazz. And it points out one thing that we must remember. The jazz soloist is not someone who is randomly taking notes out of the air and throwing them together in a chaotic, unplanned manner. Jazz is a musical vocabulary. It's very much like speaking. I can stand up to you and speak to you spontaneously. We can have a conversation, but we all have learned in our youth rules, the rules of grammar. We know how to structure sentences. We know how to form paragraphs. Once we know how to do that, then we can convey ideas through that structure. The jazz soloist learns the rules of music and the rules of harmony, just as we learn the rules of grammar, and is able to speak through the music the way we speak through the language. And here we'll once again hear Coleman Hawkins doing a very, very beautiful job of it, Body and Soul. Oh, to a pianist who would be known as probably the most influential pianist this music we call jazz has ever produced. He was a virtuoso who was recognized as such by all of the great pianists of the 20th century. He was described by Arthur Rubinstein as being the greatest pianist he'd ever seen. He was first presented formally in concert by George Gershwin. His name, of course, is Art Tatum, who was a phenomenal virtuoso who was from Toledo, Ohio, but cut his teeth in the Harlem Piano School during the late 20s. Virtuoso, unparalleled. You'll get to hear him playing extremely quick arpeggios, those are the buttons with the right hand. His harmonic sense presaged what the beboppers would be doing during the 40s, and his total command of the instrument, like it was a little toy, is utterly amazing. We're gonna hear him in 1933 performing his variations on T for Two. In fact, people like Horowitz have imitated his version. I have a videotape with Horowitz dabbling a little bit, playing T for Two in the style of Art Tatum. But here is Art Tatum, 1933. It would be nice if I turned the tape over first. When you're talking sometime, you forget about all these little technical things you have to do. We get songs, you know, that don't want the tape, we get to turn the tape over, all sorts of things. But in a couple of seconds, you will be listening to our tape. I am not an instrumentalist. I studied piano, cello, and orchestral percussion as a child, but by the time I got into my late teens and early 20s and started to see the master's plan, I said, this is not my calling. My mother relies otherwise.
Thank you.
Mark Tatum. 1933. We're going to jump now to 1946 and listen to the music of someone who is to radically change the way jazz was played. And in fact, when we look at the music, the AD and BC of jazz is really divided by the year 1942, the year that Charlie Parker came to New York. And Charlie Parker's influences on jazz, first of all, was rhythmic. He greatly elevated the level of complexity of the music rhythmically by placing very sophisticated accents in the music. Harmonically, he developed the use of extended and very advanced harmonic structures and very advanced harmonic approaches to the American popular song. And with the technical virtuosity, he astounded the day. Most of all, though, he was a great blues player and understood that very basic sensibility of the blues, which is at the core of all American music, whether it be jazz, rock and roll, or believe it or not, country and western. We're in Nashville. If you listen to the basics of country and western, you'll hear blues progressions under the melodies. The melodies may come from Europe and Ireland, but the chordal structure, the harmonic structure of the music, comes from the blues from Africa. So we're going to hear two Charlie Parker pieces from 1946 and 1945. First, a very, very short break. A break is a place in the music where all the instrumentalists drop out and just the soloist plays. We'll hear a short alto saxophone break by Charlie Parker on a composition entitled The Night in Tunisia by Dizzy Gillespie. And then we're going to hear Charlie Parker's very famous variation on the Ray Noble standard Cherokee. He calls it Coco, and you'll see the virtuosity of Parker displayed in these two pieces. Now what the beboppers would do, they would take the chord progressions, the harmonic structure of many of the popular song composers of what we call Tin Pan Alley. I like to call it the American art song. And they would write new, more complex melody lines on top of the harmonic structure. And they would write these really jagged, very fast-played musical lines. And with Coco, you'll get to hear that. But if you listen to the chords that the piano player is playing, and if you sing to yourself, you'll be able to sing the melody to Cherokee. It'll just be very, very fast. First, famous alto break on Night in Tunisia, and then Coco, Charlie Parker's variation of Cherokee. And on Coco, you'll hear Dizzy Gillespie playing the introduction to the piece on trumpet with Charlie Parker on alto. And then during Charlie Parker's solo, Dizzy will switch to the piano and play the chords behind him. At this time when it was recorded, there weren't a whole lot of musicians who understood what Parker and Gillespie were doing together. And so Parker had Gillespie play both trumpet and piano on this piece. Thank you. Gillespie 1947 big band recording entitled Cool Breeze. And we think of the music of bebop as largely a small group music. And to a large extent it was. You had quartets, quintets, as opposed to big bands. The reasons for this were twofold. One, jazz instrumentalists and soloists wanted more space to take longer and more interesting solos, and the big bands restricted it because jazz musicians tend to like to spread the solos around, and the big band would be going on for days. But plus, the economics of jazz. And the big bands started to die out during the late 40s. And it really was, again, due to technology. The introduction of the jukebox into clubs took away the necessity of hiring bands to work at every single club, because you wouldn't want to pay a big band when you can hire or buy a jukebox and just rent records. So big bands tended to decline, musicians tended to play smaller and smaller and smaller groups. Though Dizzy Gillespie led a big band from 1945 to 1947, and again from 1955 to 1956. And we're gonna hear a 1947 recording of Cool Breeze. Now what Dizzy did was Dizzy took the bebop sounds that he and Parker worked and combined them with the rhythms of Africa, which he had gotten and learned through Cuban percussionist Chanopozo, who had came to New York. And Chanopozo, who didn't speak very much English, used to say, Dizzy, no speaky Spanish, me, no speaky much English, but we both speak African. And through the African music that he had learned growing up in Havana, Cuba, the Yoruba chants, because largely the people of Cuba were largely Yorubas from West Africa, where Nigeria is today. And he brought those Yoruba chants and that Yoruba drumming to jazz and combined it. And we're gonna hear Cool Breeze. James Moody was in this band, Dexter Gordon, a lot of great musicians came out of this big band. Dizzy Gillespie.
Ha ha ha!
portion of the program. We have some short video clips. First, of a Gambian kora player. You'll see the string kora instrument. It's a gourd with a long stick and like six strings attached to it. Then we'll hear the music of an African bluesman, a member of the Ganawa people who live in present-day Morocco, but who moved from Morocco to Morocco from West Africa, from the country of what's now Mali, or the latter-day Sangha Empire, during the internal slave trade, and who traced their origin before that to ancient Egypt. They play an instrument called gimri, which you'll recognize as an early guitar. They play a style of music that resembles the blues, it is the blues, also has the underpinnings of sometimes of country and western. You can hear that down, 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 down in it at various times. We'll have a short clip of a gimri player playing with a group of musicians from Persia and also some jazz musicians from the United States, Randy Weston being the leader of it, in a project done a couple of years ago in Morocco. It's kind of international music thing. I want you to catch the gimri player. Then we have a short clip of Louis Armstrong performing with a big band doing Dinah. Then we have a short clip of Sidney Bechet, and then a short film, Duke Ellington's Symphony in Black, recorded in 1933. Then we have Coleman Hawkins performing the quartet setting, and then adding Roy Eldridge to it, and we end up with Charlie Parker and Dizzy Gillespie. So I'm gonna put the films on right now.
That's seven.
Seven short little clips. And after that, for those of you who can hang out a little bit longer, we'll have questions about it. The floor is open for any questions that you may have. That was a tune called Hot House, composed by Tad Dameron. That was Charlie Parker on alto saxophone, Dizzy Gillespie on trumpet.
Big bands. Doesn't Dizzy Gillespie work with the big bands of Les Height, Coleman Hawkins, and a lot of the other swing bands in the 30s? And he developed that style like Roy Eldridge during the big band era. Roy Eldridge was known as a musician most likely to want to encounter other musicians in a jam session, or what they used to call cutting sessions, where the musicians would go up against each other and try to outplay each other. Roy Eldridge's motto was, "Have trumpet, we'll play." And you saw how he came into the room like leading his like coming to play. Just like Willie the Lion Smith used to be on the piano, "You gotta come past me." Roy Eldridge up into his 60s would be the younger trumpet player. "You have to get past me. Come on, let's play, let's see what you can do. What do you have to say?" So the sisters have that same tradition behind them, that same style.
I have rather a personal question. I'd like to find some tapes or recordings of Papa Celestine, Dixieland.
Probably check Tower Records here in Nashville. I noticed there was a Tower Records here. Right. If they don't have it in stock, they can definitely order it.
Okay, thank you very much.
Because they're a wonderful store. That's kind of amazing.
Sir, what's the chance, for instance, of getting a recording of Sidney Bechet?
Well, again, Tower Records should have it. A lot of the stuff is in print. I can recommend to you two recordings, Sidney Bechet Volume 1, Sidney Bechet Volume 2 on Blue Note Records. It was last issued in 1974 on French Blue Note, but still in the catalog. There's also a 6-record set on French RCA, Volumes 1 through 6, double record set. It's RCA, French RCA, Black and White series. Tower also carries those. If they don't have them in the Tower here, have them order it for you. And if they don't want to order it for you, you can call Tower 800 in New York, and you can mail order it with your credit card. Sidney Bechet is Volume 1 through 6. There are 3 double record sets on French RCA. Any more questions? Okay, well, thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. was trying to send to you guys. And then when the power went off, it pushed us back, so this is not accurate.
No, I don't worry about it.